Good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the portfolio on this occasion is social justice. Anyone wishing to ask a supplementary should press the request to speak button during the relevant question. There's quite a bit of interest in supplementaries, so the usual appeal for brief questions that don't come in four or five parts, and similarly brief responses from the front bench. And I call question number one, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether a greater increase in the Scottish Child Payment or a council tax freeze will do more to help families in poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Child Payment is providing well-targeted support to the lowest income families and is estimated to lift 50,000 children out of poverty this year. We have committed to increasing it in line with inflation to £26.70 per week from April, with 329,000 children expected to benefit in 24-25. This Government is working with local authorities to help them deliver the council tax fees and provide much-needed financial relief to over 2 million council taxpayers. Both of these measures, provided for in the Budget, are unparalleled in the UK and will provide much-needed help for families.
John Mason.
Some people, especially some in the third sector, have argued that actually a council tax freeze doesn't help the poorest because they're already not paying council tax, but it does help those who are better off who are paying more council tax. How would she respond to people like that?
Cabinet Secretary.
As a proportion of income, those on the lowest incomes will benefit the most from a council tax freeze. This is because council tax represents a larger proportion of their income than those who are better off. This is on top of the council tax reduction scheme, which supports those that cannot be expected to afford council tax. However, the cost crisis has seen bills rise for households across the spectrum, and this freeze will give some certainty to them for next year.
And supplementary, Jeremy Balfour.
Cabinet Secretary, councils across Scotland are having to slash their budgets due to this tax freeze. It means that local services helping those in the most deprived areas are going to come to an end. How does that help them?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, as has been made clear on numerous occasions, both by the First Minister, Deputy First Minister, and I'm happy to say so once again, the council tax freeze will be fully funded by the Scottish Government. That work is ongoing with COSLA around the details of that proposals, and that's a very important reassurance which I'm pleased to be able to give to the Chamber again today.
And Ivan McKee.
The council tax is recognised as regressive, contrary to the Government's stated progressive outlook. Can I ask what work has been undertaken to evaluate other models of less regressive and more proportionate property or land value taxes, and when the Government expects to complete this work?
Cabinet Secretary.
So council tax represents a larger proportion of income overall income for lower income households than for richer households, and the council tax fees recognises the regressive impact of council tax. That does underline the importance of reform, and we're committed to a fairer and more inclusive and fiscally sustainable form of local taxation. I've convened the Joint Working Group on Sources of Local Government Funding and Council Tax Reform. That group is co-chaired by Scottish Ministers and COSLA.
Thank you. Question two, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will update its guidance to local authorities on planning rules for short-term lets, in light of the recent ruling from the Court of Session that deemed the City of Edinburgh Council's planning guidance for businesses on short-term lets to be unlawful.
Minister Paul McLennan.
In bringing the judicial review of the City of Edinburgh Council's local guidance, the petitioners noted that it was not consistent with the Scottish Government's guidance. In issuing its decision, the Court agreed with the Scottish Government's position on the interpretation of the relevant legislation. Therefore, the Scottish Government does not consider it necessary to update its current guidance set out in Planning Circular 1/2023.
Murdo Fraser.
Can I thank the Minister for his response? But I'm sure he would acknowledge that there is confusion around the law on planning for short-term lets, with different councils taking different approaches. Some councils now require operators of short-term lets, even if they've been operating for some time, to apply for retrospective planning consent before they will grant a short-term let. Other councils take a different approach. Does the Minister not think that updated guidance from the Scottish Government would be helpful so we have a uniformity of approach across the country instead of the confusion that we currently have?
Minister.
Yeah, thank you. I think one of the most important points obviously was when we set out the policy was giving local authorities the ability to have their own flexibility and that was something in discussing with SOLAR that they supported. I think in coming back in terms of Edinburgh Council itself, and I'm aware that they are speaking to petitioners at the moment to try and clarify some of the points that were raised through that. I don't know, discussions are ongoing in that regard.
Supplementary, Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Will the Minister make it clear that the court ruling applies only to the City of Edinburgh Council's short-term lets policy and that the national legislation underpinning the licence scheme remains robust and applicable across Scotland with a considerable degree of local discretion?
Minister.
Just as I previously mentioned in my previous answer, I can confirm that ruling applies only to a local planning policy of City of Edinburgh Council that relates to the Council's interpretation and implementation of legislation for designated short-term let control areas. The ruling does not impact in any way on either planning or short-term let licensing legislation, nor indeed was the Court asked to consider any matters relating to legislation as part of the judicial review. Our view is licensing and planning of short-term let accommodation can be operated effectively by authorities so as to respect the rights of hosts and guests.
Thank you. Question 3, Claire Adamson.
Sorry. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what social security support is available to people in Motherwell and Wishaw constituency who are experiencing poverty, including fuel poverty.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government's priority is to do everything we can to help those worst affected by the cost of living crisis, which is why since 22-23 we have continued to allocate around £3 billion a year to support policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible. This includes our investment of over £22 million this winter through our winter heating payment to support around 400,000 households in the lowest incomes to heat their homes. We've also invested over £7 million this year, making over 30,000 payments of child winter heating payment to children, young people and their families in Scotland who may have higher fuel needs due to their disability or health condition. There is no equivalent support available elsewhere in the UK. We continue to raise our investment, increasing all social security benefits in 24-25 by 6.7% in recognition of the challenges being faced across Scotland.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Minister for her answer. The energy companies are resuming the installation of prepayment meters under warrant following updated advice from Ofgem. I have contacted Ofgem and major energy suppliers to say that this is a last resort. However, my constituents in Motherwell and Wishaw at the sharp end of this unfair practice by the energy suppliers tell a very different story. As energy policy remains reserved to Westminster, what engagement has the Scottish Government had with UK Government regarding the unfair position faced by people who are forced to take prepayment meters?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I very much share the members' concerns regarding the reintroduction of forced prepayment meter installations. Ofgem's Code of Practice requiring suppliers to meet a number of conditions before taking such action is an important step. However, too many households remain at risk from this practice, especially with energy costs remaining so high. We believe that energy suppliers must exhaust all options, including meaningful support to struggling households to manage debt, before imposing prepayment meters. The Minister for Energy and the Environment has raised this matter previously with the Minister for Affordability and Skills and will continue to pursue this in meetings with the UK Government and Ofgem in the coming weeks.
Question 4, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it holds Social Security Scotland to account to ensure that it is fulfilling its responsibility to help claimants who request support to provide supporting information, include obtaining it on their behalf.
Cabinet Secretary.
Social Security Scotland framework document provides accountability and governance to ensure Social Security Scotland meets its statutory obligations. The framework requires delivery in keeping with our core values of dignity, fairness and respect. Encouraging people to access the benefits they are entitled to and assisting them through our application process are rights enshrined in the Social Security Charter. Assisting people to gather supporting information for disability assistance is a fundamental part of delivering these obligations. Reviewing performance on this is a frequent priority in my discussions with the Chief Executive of Social Security Scotland.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. The Cabinet Secretary recently informed me that Social Security Scotland are committed to ensuring people applying for disability assistance are helped to provide supporting information, which can include obtaining it on their behalf. My constituent advised that, as his claim was considered, he was not contacted once or nor were the clinicals he provided to verify the claims. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what data is kept on the number of applicants who may need additional assistance with applications and how often it reviews this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm afraid from the information the member has given, or indeed our previous correspondence, he has not directed me to a particular constituent and an issue on this. If he has the permission of the constituent to do so, I would be happy to receive that information and work with the agency to look into it, because clearly one of the integral parts of the work on adult disability payment is to assist those to gather supporting information, and that's a very important part of the work. So if the member would wish to do so, I know we have corresponded on this matter previously, but I'm not aware that he's raised a particular case where there has been an issue, and I would be, of course, very pleased, along with the agency, to look into that and get back to the member in correspondence.
And supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The support that Social Security Scotland provides to claimants has helped them build their remarkably high satisfaction ratings, which stand in stark contrast to the reputation of the UK Government's Department of Work and Pensions. Has the Cabinet Secretary had any recent discussion with Social Security Scotland as to how they can maintain or even improve claimants' experiences?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I have been very pleased to have regular discussions with the agency's executive team on how we can build on the high satisfaction ratings. For example, around 9 in 10 survey respondents said they were treated with kindness and were treated with dignity, fairness and respect. This is, of course, in stark contrast to the reports from the DWP's previous system, particularly on personal independence payment. Still, clearly, there is work to do to ensure that we are delivering that service for everyone, and I'm more than happy to always work with members to see what more can be done to improve that.
Question 5, Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is offering to local authorities to help people stuck in temporary accommodation.
Minister.
We have committed to reducing the use of temporary accommodation, and in response to the recommendations of the Temporary Accommodation Task and Finish Group, are investing at least £60 million through the £752 million Affordable Housing Supply Programme in 23-24 to support a national acquisition plan. We are working with partners to develop a new programme for social landlords to maximise the use of existing housing stock alongside targeted partnership plans with the local authorities facing the greatest pressures. Additional funding of £2 million in 23-24 has been targeted at local authorities with the largest percentage increases in temporary accommodation.
Megan Gallagher.
What the Minister failed to mention is that there are more than 15,000 households stuck in temporary accommodation. The 2024 Scottish Homelessness Monitor predicts that homelessness is expected to increase by 33% by 2026. But what I find shocking is that this SNP government has chosen to cut the housing budget and to starve councils of funding necessary to tackle these issues. Therefore, I ask the Scottish Government if it plans to declare a housing emergency to ensure that the Scottish Homelessness Monitor's predictions do not come to fruition.
Minister.
Can I thank the member for her question? A few points I think are important. There's a 10% capital cut from her government, which I hope she would take back in terms of that. And I'm glad she's mentioned the Homelessness Monitor, because one of the key things the Homelessness Monitor actually represents is the biggest increase is due to the LHA being frozen over a number of years. The LHA, and that's a report. Read the report, it says the exact same thing. It says about that, and it also mentions about benefit rates as being the biggest factor. So if she's really serious about that, go back to your Chancellor about the budget, it's coming in March, and discuss these issues. We also spend near enough £100 million a year on discretionary housing payments to support that. Now, if we had a decent level of local housing allowance, we wouldn't need to do that. So again, there are three main points I think she needs to take back in that regard. So I'm glad you mentioned that, because I said the biggest impact is poverty, of which your government is adding to.
Through the chair, please, Minister. Thank you. Question number 6, Katie Clark.
Ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to ensure it meets its affordable homes target by 2032.
Minister.
To September 2023, 15,765 homes have been delivered towards the 110,000 target, of which 77% are for social rent. The UK budget has meant a 10% real terms fall on our UK capital funding between 23-24 and 27-28. Inflationary pressures, Brexit impacts and wider market conditions have triggered rising construction costs and workforce challenges. We remain focused on our target of delivering 110,000 affordable homes by 2032. And to support that, we'll also bring forward a review scheduled for 26-27 to 2024 with a focus on deliverability. We're also accelerating work with the financial community to boost private sector investment.
Katie Clark.
Nearly £200 million is to be cut from the Affordable Homes Supply Programme. The number of social homes which began construction was down 41% in 2023. An average of 7,700 new social homes need to be built every year to meet the target. So how does the Minister believe that can be achieved if funding is to be cut?
Minister. I think I've referred the member to recent, the previous question, just in about the 10% cut in real terms in that. And I think that's an issue. I think to mention that, we have to deal with that. I think some of the issues, and there was evidence given to the Finance Committee from the IFS around about the cuts in the Scottish Government budget, the cuts in the Welsh Government budget, to basically pay for tax cuts. So it's a decision that it's been made in terms of, I meet and work with local authorities in terms of how we can maximise the availability of their programmes on their own. And I think there's also a challenge to Katie Clark and her party. If they are successful in the election, I think one of the key things they need to look at, obviously, is around about the capital cut and reversing that, and also about LHA rates, which I think are important. So hopefully, you know, if that does happen and there's Labour government elected later on, you know, hopefully we can discuss that and bring that forward, because these are the main things that are impacting on our deliverability.
Of supplementaries. First, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister confirm that the last Labour administration built only six council houses in Scotland between 2003 and 2007, and this SNP government, despite Tory austerity and Sir Keir Starmer's refusal to turn on the taps if he becomes Prime Minister, is still building 1,157 this year, nearly 200 times more than Labour built over 4 years?
Minister.
I thank Mr Gibson for his question. Yes, indeed, a total of six council houses were built in the last 4 years of the Labour-led government in Scotland. A stark contrast to the last 4 years of this government, when 7,564 new council houses were built. This is 1,260 times higher than under the last 4 years of the Labour-led government. I'm proud that from April 2007 to end of September 2023, we have worked with the sector to deliver 126,396 affordable homes, over 89,000 of which were for social rent, including 23,625 council homes. Now, it comes back to the point that Mr Gibson mentioned around about Keir Starmer saying about refusal to turn on the taps. There's a real challenge for Labour in this if they are elected, and I'll come back to that point later on in the year.
And Miles Briggs.
Deputy Presiding Officer, Scotland's affordable homes targets risk becoming an impossible dream, not my words, but the words of the Chief Executive of the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations across Scotland. The Scottish Government set a target of 10% of all affordable homes to be in rural and island communities. Last year, though, we saw a record low in approvals and completions. So can I ask the Minister, does he now accept that this target is unlikely to be met?
Minister.
I think in my first question to Katie Clark, I mentioned in the bit of review we're scheduling for 26, 27 to 2024 with a focus on deliverability. And obviously he mentioned in the bit some of the issues that obviously have an impact on that, inflationary pressures, talked about Brexit impacts, and obviously wider market conditions haven't helped that, and obviously the 10% cut I mentioned in capital terms in that respect. So I think, and he mentioned also rural homes as well, obviously part of the discussions with rural developers I've been having has been the cost of construction, which has impacted on that. And again, that comes back to where interest rates are, inflation, construction inflation over that period of time. So, and again, I continue to meet with local authorities in these areas to bring forward houses in rural areas as well.
Question 7, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to increase the number of new homes started in rural areas.
Minister Paul McLennan.
I've been engaging closely with a range of partners, including local authorities, housing providers and business, including a recent roundtable event to support the delivery of more affordable homes across rural Scotland. This work is underpinned by a recently published Rural and Island Housing Action Plan. We will invest over £556 million in affordable homes across Scotland next financial year, including the demand-led Rural and Islands Housing Fund and Rural Affordable Homes for Key Workers Fund. We also provided funding for Communities Housing Trust and South of Scotland Community Housing Houses Trust to support communities to deliver more affordable homes in rural and island communities.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. That's helpful, Minister. But can I just double-check that out of the 110,000 affordable homes that are planned by 2032, that 10% is the figure that is supposed to be built in the rural and island communities? Can I just check that figure, please, because there seemed a bit confusion about it. And secondly, that obviously the latest housing statistics from the last quarter in 2023 showed that the number of new homes started had decreased by 24%. Can you tell us how that's going to impact on your ambitions to ensure that the rural areas are well served, given that they are so critical to the sustainability of our rural communities?
Again, through the Chair, but Minister.
Can I thank the member for her question? I think there was a previous debate that obviously to refer to where we talked around about 10% being a minimum target. So again, we'll work with local authorities in that regard. So 10% is a minimum that we're aiming for. If we can obviously deliver more than that, we will deliver more than that. So 10% is a minimum target. I mentioned about the round table we're having in terms of that was with major employers, talking around about opportunities about the Key Workers Fund, for example. And I talked about in the previous answer when working with the Communities Housing Trust and so on, and deliverability of that. I think there are other opportunities that we're kind of looking at as well. She'll be aware of some of the developments in the renewable sector around about Inverness and so on. And we, I spoke to developers up there along with the local community and a local authority in terms of the opportunities around about that, not just around about Inverness, but in areas surrounding that. So there are six or seven renewable hubs that we're looking to see how we can deliver that in terms of that. So these are mostly in rural areas as well, so there's an opportunity to develop more housing in these, working with the sector, working with developers and so on. Happy to discuss later on.
And supplementary from Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many young people want the chance to live in the rural and island areas where they've grown up and where they have family ties. Even a small number of new properties can have a significant benefit, like the development in my constituency by Hiatland Housing Association of four new homes in Walls. The outcome of methodology to determine where new houses are built can sometimes differ, though, from the needs expressed by communities. So what action can the Scottish Government take on this point?
Minister.
Yeah, can I thank Beatrice Wishart for that? She will know I visited Shetland a number of months ago and spoke to Highlands around about that. She'll know there was infrastructure funding provided as well about the site. Up there, and again, you know, and a particular challenge here sometimes is about the topography of the area, right? And she knows we're working very closely with Shetland and the Council in that regard. I know Shetland's had its specific challenges around about the renewable sector and other sectors where it's grown, which has put real pressure on an area. So I continue to work very closely with Shetland in terms of that. We'll have follow-up meetings with them in that regard. And I think one of the key things is coming back is meeting with local authorities to discuss their own individual challenges, of which Shetland obviously has, and I'll continue to discuss their particular issues with Shetland.
Question 8, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to improve the lives of disabled people.
Minister Emma Roddick.
The Scottish Government is working hard to improve the lives of disabled people. The Independent Living Fund, which supports disabled people, will reopen to new applicants after receiving a £9 million investment as part of the 2024-25 Scottish Budget. That will support around 1,000 new applicants. And later this year, we will implement an immediate priorities plan developed in co-production with disabled people's organisations that will deliver a range of actions to support disabled people. In addition, £5 million from our Equality and Human Rights Fund supports disabled people's organisations to tackle inequality and discrimination, furthering equality and advancing the realisation of human rights in Scotland.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. The SNP Government claim that Social Security Scotland is founded on dignity, fairness and respect. However, Scots with disabilities are being let down by the system. Specifically, the latest Social Security Scotland statistics show that more than a third of adult disability payment applications have been denied, while the average processing times for the child disability payment is around 5 months. So can I ask what action is being taken to ensure that everyone in need of disability benefits receive them in a timely manner?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government recognises that some people have waited too long to have their applications decided through Social Security Scotland, but work is ongoing to address this and has been improving the situation at pace. I absolutely stand by Social Security Scotland being embedded in dignity, fairness and respect, and that is borne out with the customer client reviews that we have received from Social Security Scotland telling us that the process is far beyond those that the DWP down south receive for similar benefits. So I would urge the member to ensure that the communications going out to constituents who should feel able to come forward to Social Security Scotland for support and know that they are going to be welcomed and supported to do so is the message that people hear.
And a couple of brief supplementaries. First, Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you. Can the Minister outline how the reopening of the Independent Living Fund will align with the work of Social Security Scotland to support the well-being of disabled people?
Minister.
The Scottish Government recognises the pressures on household budgets, including those of disabled people who are disproportionately impacted and being stretched due to the ongoing cost of living crisis. That is why since 2022-23 we continue to allocate around £3 billion a year to social security policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible. The Independent Living Fund, of course, provides additional funding to disabled people alongside social security and social care funding to obtain support to help them to live more independently. The reopening of the fund realises our commitment to further support disabled people who need it most, and the £9 million extra investment will provide up to 1,000 new recipients the ability to exercise greater choice and control over the care and support they receive so that they can be better supported both in their homes and in their communities.
And briefly, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Homes for Scotland Existing Housing Needs Report this week showed that 85,000 households are living in properties that do not have adaptations or the support required for the disabled people who live in them. The 27% cut to the housing budget is not going to help in terms of driving forward the progress we need to see on ageing adaptations. So can the Minister, with the responsibility for equality, tell the Chamber what assessment was made of the impact that will have on disabled people across Scotland?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, we are all too aware that older and disabled people may struggle to find housing that meets their needs, and we are taking steps to mitigate that. We are increasing the supply of accessible and adapted housing.
Thank you. That concludes portfolio questions on social justice. There will be a brief pause to allow front benches to change before we move on to the next item of business.